Hi everybody, it's Maija and we're here at the Nori Point Environmental Center. Today we are going to be looking at a new and kind of emerging environmental contaminant that people are just starting to learn about here on the Hudson River. The study area today is microplastics and marine debris. So microplastics are any type of plastic that is 5 millimeters in diameter or smaller. So that's quite small. And microplastics make their way into the Hudson a few different ways, but the primary source is from marine debris. It could be anything from a plastic bag, a straw, some garbage, a styrofoam cup, things like that that make their way to the river, whether it's from the watershed or from people directly dumping garbage. Once the marine debris, the plastics of larger sizes, get into the river, they break down into smaller and smaller pieces. And it's not that they break down and go away, but they get broken up, either ripped or torn or degraded from a number of different sources. One could be from wave action, one could be from ice or wind. And another way that plastics break into smaller pieces is UV light or sunlight that degrades the plastic themselves. So the way we look at microplastics in the Hudson is by using a tool like this. This is a plankton tow, and this is actually developed to collect tiny plants and tiny animals that are floating in the water. So a net like this, you put in the water and you drag it along, water filters through, and everything else gets captured inside. So on the Hudson now, pretty much anywhere that you can collect zooplankton or phytoplankton, you know, tiny living things, you are also gonna be able to find microplastic. All right, let's throw it in the water. All right, now we're in the lab. We've taken our sample that we collected from the Hudson River and sifted it through this tool and taken some time to look through the sample and pull out anything that looks like it might not be biological. A lot of times there are things that look biological that are plastic, and there's a lot of things that look plastic that are actually an egg of a fish or a piece of a plant. So it's kind of hard to determine, but we've done a careful job of sorting through this sample and pulling out the things that are microplastics. Again, that means that they are pieces of plastic smaller than 5 millimeters, and they come in different shapes. So I'm going to show you some of the shapes of plastics that we found today. First, we have a microfiber. So you'll see that this is a little piece of string that could have come from a number of different sources. We also have a microfragment. This is a broken off piece of plastic. Also could have a number of different sources. Then you'll see foam. This could come from a couple of different things, but is often like a foam cup or a styrofoam food container of some kind. And then we have microbeads as well, which are spherical little plastic balls. So the reason why we categorize our microplastics into these different shapes is, as I was mentioning, they come from different sources. And when you know the sources of the different plastics, it's easier to go about determining how to reduce the amount of plastic making its way into the river and breaking down into microplastics. So microfragment can come from something like a plastic bag as it blows onto the watershed and eventually makes its way down into the stream. It'll break down into smaller and smaller pieces. Microfiber may be coming from some filament, maybe rope, may come from fishing line. Most often, microfibers are actually coming from clothing. So the little fibers that are coming off of our clothes when we wash them, and it goes into a tributary and then eventually comes into the Hudson River, gets mixed up with the water column and comes out as these little fibers in the water. Other fragments may come from plastic bottles, and straws are a big culprit as well. And then there's the foam, which generally is coming from either a coffee cup or a food container of some kind. Then we have the microbeads, which they may be coming from a face wash that has microbeads in it, or some of our toys have beads inside of them, nurdles inside of them, which are little plastic balls that actually look a lot like fish eggs and are made to be these little balls of plastic. So why do we care if there's plastic in the water? Well, a lot of the plastic mimics biological things, like the microbeads really look a lot like fish eggs. And there are a lot of animals that eat fish eggs, and they subsequently also now eat plastic. There are a lot of other, like, microfibers that look like pieces of plant. So a lot of other animals also eat small plants and inadvertently ingest microfibers. This is actually true of people as well. There have been studies that show almost all of our drinking water, whether it's bottled or from the tap, and almost all of our table salt has some traces of plastic in it. So it's getting into our bodies, it's getting into the bodies of fish and birds, and that's not good for any of us. There are a lot of ways to reduce the amount of microplastics that make it into our water. One way is, as with plastic bags and with microbeads and face washes, laws and regulations can limit the amount of use and release into a waterway. Some have to do with personal choices, like reducing the amount of water bottles used by using your own reusable water bottle. Another has to do with consumer choices. So if you choose a piece of clothing that's made out of acrylic or plastic versus something that's made out of cotton or wool. And some have to do with communities coming together. So doing beach cleanups or stream cleanups in order to pick up some of the marine debris that's made its way into the stream, that can keep it from getting into the Hudson and then breaking down and becoming a microplastic. So we'd like to encourage everyone to think of ways that you can reduce the amount of plastic that you use in your life and how it might get into the river. Thanks everyone, and we'll see you again soon.